This episode is sponsored by Brilliant.
You're faced with a dilemma.
There's a rogue trolley headed straight for five people. There's a lever which, when pulled, changes the trolley's course, saving the five people, but killing one. If you do nothing, five people will die. If you pull the lever, you save five, but kill one who would have otherwise been safe. With only seconds to act, what do you do?
This is a famous question in philosophy called the trolley problem, and philosophers have been arguing about it for centuries. Some say the right thing to do is to pull the lever, as saving five lives is obviously better than saving one, while others say that the act of pulling the lever means that you're responsible for the death, and if you'd done nothing, it would have just been letting fate happen. We're still far from reaching a consensus on the matter, and the battle of right and wrong still continues. And that's been fine. Until now. Self-driving cars are estimated to be on the roads in the not-too-distant future, and accidents will inevitably happen. Programmers will need to decide beforehand how the car should act in a life-or-death situation. So should we just round up all the philosophers and ethicists and lock them in a room until they can all agree? Well, a professor of computational social choice, Ariel Prakacha from Carnegie Mellon University, had a better idea.
The story starts with a visit to MIT. Where when talking to other computer scientists, Professor Prakacha and his PhD, Ritesh, heard about the most fascinating experiment, the Moral Machine Experiment.
A group at MIT created a website which presents you with a number of different self-driving car catastrophes, and you can choose which you think is the most morally correct. For example,
here we have a self-driving car that had a sudden brake failure. Should it A, continue ahead and crash into the barrier, killing the passengers, two dogs, which are apparently driving the car, one elderly woman and two female athletes, or should it swerve and kill one cat, one male athlete, one elderly man and one pregnant woman? In this case, we choose between the car killing two female executives, one man and two male executives, or three homeless people, one woman and one man.
The team at MIT collected over 40 million votes from over a million users all around the world, and some of the results are pretty interesting. Like most people would spare a dog's life over a criminal's, and while Western countries tended to spare the young over the elderly, in Middle Eastern and Asian countries this was much less pronounced.
Anyway, when talking about this, Professor Prakacha realized that this data not only revealed decisions, it could be used to automate decisions. In other words, this data could be used to tell self-driving cars how to act in life-threatening situations. In the words of Professor Prakacha, they could create a virtual democracy.
Now, what I find so fascinating about this approach is that it seems simple when you hear it, but it's so opposite to any approach we've tried in the past. Most approaches to date have been top-down, in that we try and find the foundational laws first, like Asimov's laws of robotics, for example, and build off of those. This is completely different in that we examine the opinion of millions and then aggregate those into a final decision. Now, Professor Prakacha said that this actually caused a lot of controversy in the ethics community, with people saying things like, "Oh, we've been talking about the trolley problem for centuries and you think you've just solved it all in one paper?" But the whole point of this approach is that we can deal with the trolley problem without having to actually solve the trolley problem. I don't know, I think that's really clever. Now moving on to the more technical stuff, because I know that's why you're here. How did the team actually implement this idea? What was the computer science involved? I think the main questions are,
how would a self-driving car deal with new scenarios that hadn't been included in the Moral Machine experiment? There will typically be seconds or even microseconds for a self-driving car to assess a situation and act accordingly. How will it make the right decision so quickly? How can one algorithm represent over a million people's preferences and over 40 million votes?
Now, this stuff is pretty advanced for me, so I have a friend with us today who's greatly studied ethics in AI. His name's Lei, and he runs the science YouTube channel Science for All, which talks about AI research and algorithms. He also has a rather lovely French accent. Lei, can you tell us more about how this all works?
Hey Jade, for sure. Let's give an overview of the process. It consists of four steps. First, the data collection, which as you've mentioned, was done in the Moral Machine experiment. Second, the learning step. The goal here is to use the data from the Moral Machine experiment to learn a model that extrapolates the preferences of each voter to all possible alternatives. Third, the summarization step. Combine the individual models into a single model, which approximately captures the collective preferences of all voters over all alternatives in a more efficient manner to allow for faster future computations. And finally, aggregation, where you use a summarized model to run a virtual democracy to come up with a decision. You already covered step one, Jade, so I'll now start with the next step, learning. So each voter is given a bunch of scenarios where they have to choose the best outcome. Now, the options always come in pairs in the moral machine experiment. This is because people reason much more clearly about hypotheticals with two alternatives rather than having to, say, give each situation a score according to their preference. For example, if someone asks you, do you prefer chocolate or vanilla ice cream? It's much easier to answer than if they asked you to score these 100 ice cream flavors from your favorite to your least favorite. Essentially, you get much more accurate information from people when you present them with hypothetical scenarios and ask them to choose. However, a score is a lot more useful. You can figure out trends like maybe you like sweet ice cream flavors and don't like bitter flavors. Or you prefer to save infants and babies over adults, or you value human lives over animals. But luckily, machine learning algorithms have become quite good at inferring scores from pairwise comparisons, especially if they can assume that such scores are obtained by combining the inferences of different features like sweetness or bitterness. Or in the case of the trolley problem, such features may include humans versus pets, swerving versus staying in line, and so on. But let's keep it simple for now. Let's just consider three factors: age, wealth, and weight. Say there's a person who really values the elderly, the rich, and the voluptuous, and assume they value all of these things equally. So let's say they assign a weight of 1 to each feature. So if we change one of these factors, this will affect the score. In this alternative, where the person they could save is skinny, poor, and young, they would give a low score, and when the person they could save is rich, fat, and old, they would give a high score. Now, note that this judgment is what we have inferred from data, and we should thus be quite uncertain about our extrapolation. Plus, many other features that have not been modeled may affect the person's preferences. As a result, we should not only predict a score, but we should also add that there is uncertainty about this score, and we should even quantify this uncertainty. Of course, in practice, this is probably not how people would actually score such and such alternative. In some sense, our algorithm is not trying to mimic the person's reasoning. It rather tries to extrapolate from the data from the moral machine experiment how a voter would act when faced with a new scenario. Thereby, the algorithm learns a so-called scoring function. But the problem is that we have too many of these scoring functions. In a real-life situation, a self-driving car will have seconds or even microseconds to analyze a situation and act accordingly. If a million people did the moral machine experiment, there would be a million scoring functions, which would take too long to sift through to find an answer. So what the researchers did was combine all of these functions into a summarized function which can run in a matter of seconds. Now, of course, there is a trade-off between how fast the algorithm runs and how accurate it will be. Obviously, the ideal situation is to ask each voter what they would prefer, but because time is of the essence, the best we can do is crunch all their predicted preferences into one function which loses the least information possible. Surprisingly, the researchers managed to maintain around 96.2% accuracy. This means that in 96.2% of cases, the summarized function made the same decision as if you'd run the full 1 million functions. Pretty good.
Thanks for answering our questions, Lay.
No worries, Jade.
Make sure to check out Lay's channel, Science for All, at the end of this video. Most of his videos are in French, but some of them have subtitles. So you might think that this is the end of it, but there's actually one last step. If we draw an analogy with a presidential election, we've just gathered or generated all the votes, but we still have to count them. How the votes are counted makes a huge difference to the final outcome, and many countries have different ways of counting votes. For example, in the 2016 US presidential election, Trump won even though more people voted for Hillary because of the way the US tallies their votes. If the same election were run in France, Hillary would have won. This is where the field of social choice comes in.
It's the mathematical study of political science and deals with questions like how to choose the right voting mechanism to get the most desired outcome. In terms of self-driving cars, we as a society can agree on a mechanism with the properties that we want. For example, that it shows no bias, that it's efficient, and it gives people an incentive to tell the truth rather than try to manipulate the system. In their paper, Professor Procaccia shows an example of a very simple but effective mechanism called border count, which assigns the ranking scores in an arithmetic progression. For example, the least favorite option would be given the score 0, and the next least preferred the score 1, then 2, and so on. This is very different to if they were scored on, say, an exponential progression, as this would change the outcome drastically. So that's the gist of how it works, but just before we go, Lay had some insights he was just bursting to share with us.
I personally find Professor Procaccia's work absolutely fascinating. I'd argue it really opens a new line of research at the intersection of ethics, social choice, and computer science, which is really becoming crucial for our modern world. Indeed, self-driving cars are definitely not the only automated systems that face moral dilemmas. For one thing, autonomous weapons are being developed. They have the potential to better target their victims and greatly mitigate unwanted side effects, but they are also extremely worrying and scary, at least for me. But there are also more prosaic everyday life AIs that actually already have huge impacts on our societies, like recommender systems. Many studies show that they raise huge moral issues in terms of privacy, biases, or filter bubbles. Perhaps generalizations or variants of Professor Procaccia's work could allow to better understand what ethical values should or should not be implemented in such systems. But this raises still another issue. Indeed, the more complex the moral dilemmas are, the more it seems that expertise could be relevant. Don't ethicists know better than the layman about the most important aspects of ethics? And don't people eventually change their minds as they learn more about a particular topic? In some sense, Professor Procaccia is laying the groundwork for a more general approach, not about ethics, but about meta-ethics. Instead of asking directly what is right and what is wrong, he proposed a method to determine what is right and what is wrong. Perhaps one of the greatest challenges of the upcoming century could be to determine what meta-ethics should be used, rather than what ethics should be implemented. I don't know, but I do know I find all of this fascinating.
Machine learning is already a huge part of our lives and will only continue to impact us in the future. So it's important to get familiar with the basics so you can make better informed decisions. If you would like to learn more about machine learning, I would recommend checking out today's sponsor, Brilliant. Brilliant is an interactive learning website specializing in math, physics, and computer science. It covers so many different topics, including an entire course dedicated to machine learning. This course will provide you with the basic tools needed to understand the algorithms and techniques used in everyday machine learning, including self-driving cars. The same goes for this artificial neural networks course, which I would recommend starting with if you're a beginner looking to learn more. This course gives you a real sense of how machines actually learn, starting with the concepts that link it to the human brain, leading up to more advanced techniques like demonstrating how a machine thinks about playing a game like noughts and crosses. There are tons of other courses which you can sign up to for free. However, for a true learning experience, I would recommend signing up to their premium membership. Brilliant is giving a 20% discount to the first 200 people who sign up with this link. Just go to brilliant.org/upandatom. It could make a great holiday gift for someone. Thanks for watching, guys. Make sure to check out the video we did over on Lay's channel about the possibility of human-level AI by the year 2025. This is my last video for the year. It's been such a wonderful year with you guys. I wish you all a happy holiday, and I will see you in 2019. Bye.